last thing in the speech. So let's go to the point of the unseen in their last. And so you can read those in five holes in the end of today's theorem. A negative valid is justified. Today we're going to be interested in three votes. The first vote is just the criteria for improving or promoting security and democracy. The second is that of disadvantage, yes, we vote on disadvantages. And our third vote will be that of drop marketing, it will be impacting drop marketing a little later on in our speech. So this other first vote can be a part of this speech. The last speech was first off, that how does Russia, we wanted to look at how does Russia favor the United States? How does Russia look at the United States? Well, what we already reviewed is this explanation basically, that we should not dictate our national security policy off the whim of the Russian government. We should not dictate our national security policy off the whim of the Russian government. For see, if we look at the Russian government and try to meet their demands just because they're having increased belligerence of the United States and NATO, if we dictate our policy because of what Russia says, if we look at Russia first and not the United States, rather the whole point of the issue behind it is look at the national security of each nation first. And then one of the urgencies is greater policy to this day. We need to look at the United States' national security first and not base our policy as the urgency to do it off the whim of the Russian government. The next point was that NATO countries NATO countries got attacked as well. But one of their examples was 9/11. And my first response to this is that Russia was not involved in the 9/11 attack. Their plan is only about Russian belligerence of NATO countries. Russia did not attack the United States on 9/11, so therefore this point does not stand. They have not proven to you, one, that NATO countries were ever attacked. And so what is the impact of this argument? Well, the impact of this argument is that countries do not attack alliances, especially alliances that are 28 countries strong. But what we are going to do is getting rid of the basis of NATO expansion, and therefore we cannot expand and promote democracy and security anymore. The status quo promotes democracy and security and upholds the criteria, while the experiment team does not. Now, the next one is 1997. Their evidence is they only have one piece of evidence, quoting the 1997 report. They urged to look at the 180. We as the Navy negatively urged to look at the 180. There are three instances of 1997 instances of evidence. My part already quoted all of them, so if you'd like to look at them after the evidence, after the rest. And their last one is that we need to look at our national security for first and foreign policy, and we completely agree with it. Look at the United States first, and not on the Russian side, is the best foreign policy, and that's just beginning to get the status quo. Moving on to our first question, we have to vote on the first hearing. We've already shown you that expansion, and not just NATO itself, but expansion, the foundation of NATO, promotes not only democracy, but security of the United States and other nations. It also decreases costs, but at the same time as decreasing costs, it improves security of the United States and other NATO allies. Now, next, we have to vote on the criteria as well, because our increased security is not stopping NATO expansion because Russia says they don't like it, but rather using NATO expansion as a tool to combat Russia's belligerence in Asia. And so that's why we're going to hold the criteria as a negative team, and expansion upholds the criteria rather than the negative team. Now, our second revolution, we have time to ask who to vote on this advantage. The negative ratification that comes out of the task that comes out. There are four main disadvantages. The first disadvantage is loss of the foundation of NATO, the foundation of the expansion. The second disadvantage of it is also that we're no longer ever going to be able to expand in Russia, expand NATO again. The third disadvantage is that we're using the limits of the Russian government to dictate our national security policy. And the fourth disadvantage is that the status quo and NATO promote democracy, improves the internal system of NATO and Russia, and also increases U.S. national security. That's the whole of the criteria. But if you vote negative, all these four major disadvantages come about. And we might ask, lastly, ask you to vote on that argument. The negative, the internal team dropped eight arguments in their last speech, and I'm going to go over them. They dropped the argument that decreased costs and increases national security. They dropped the argument of stopping NATO's military efforts. They dropped the argument that Russia has no current threat. No threat behind the works. They dropped the argument that 29 countries will not be attacked by Russia. They dropped the argument of they're going to indefinitely suspend NATO expansion. They dropped the argument that relationship advantage never said relationship would actually increase. the doctor's argument that there is no proof of the weapons specifically related to terrorism, the other being one example. And the last one, they never refuted an argument that expanding helps our influence in the expanded countries. So because we have full discretion, the status quo upholds democracy and security. The authority team only has advantages if we actually cast a negative on. That's what we're going to say. Thank you so much.
All right, we've all made it to the last piece of this debate. So we're kind of going to be summing up issues here, addressing negative arguments, and then we're going to take a look at some voting issues. Key issues that should decide where you place your vote at the end of this debate. Starting now with their issues, and they respond to three significant arguments. Let's see what they got. The first one talks about how we shouldn't make our policy based on just meeting Russia's demand. And we made this very clear from the very first of our speeches. We're not talking about meeting Russia's demand. We're talking about what the United States' best interests mean. It's never been about meeting Russia's demand, except to the extent that meeting their demands actually influences our national security. That's what all this comes down to. Pointing back to the criteria of improving our security. They include democracy in there, and as we pointed out, democracy can be furthered but only after security is achieved. All right, the second response under significance talks about how Russia, the response to our arguments was saying that NATO countries can't get an act. They said, well, Russia wasn't involved in 9/11. This is true, but the point remains, NATO countries, or being involved with NATO, isn't a 100% guarantee that this country suddenly won't be attacked. It's not some wonderful force field that keeps you from being penetrated by attack. It simply isn't the case. Their third response under significant talks about the disputed 1997 evidence robot. When I first stated there was only one from 1997, he was referencing the one under that argument that she was referencing. So just to clarify our facts, in our mind, we decided to consider the 1997, which is purely informational, talking about NATO having an obligation to defend countries. We cited another one from 2009. She says things, he also references as an expert from 1997. And there is one other, which we overlooked from 1997, which basically talks about the geographical implications of the events of Eastern Europe. Really nothing here that's been critical to the debate so far, and nothing that hasn't been supported also by the recent evidence. Let's take a look at our voting issues real fast. Other than criteria, and they said, well, experts say expansion promotes security and increases democracy. Now, it's interesting that I pointed out in my last speech, there is support for this evidence. There are first piece of evidence that is radically destructive and the disadvantages was actually a NATO study in that. So NATO is saying that it reduces costs, it improves security, and that it's all around good. Well, this is logical, but it's really not credible. So we need some better support for this, better support for the state. Disadvantages. Let's look at disadvantages. This is our second voting issue. A couple of things they talked about here. They said, well, there's a lack of democracy. Again, this cross applies to what I just said. Their study, which is the premise of this argument, actually came from NATO, not a resource. We've looked at multiple other sources, also earlier in the state, 2010, several of them in the 2ACs, all talking about maybe it's actually detrimental for security as a whole. A very interesting point that they brought up under today was their point talking about how this is forever, it lasts forever, it's forever and always. Responding to this before, we'll just restate it because it wasn't really refuted. Essentially, this makes debate meaningless because any policy we're changing is something that the government currently approves of, and as negative, you could say, well, as soon as you change it, the government will change it back. In debate, it kind of operates under the premise or the assumption that the government is going to leave it alone as soon as you change it. This really doesn't impact the interpretive life. The third voting issue, they talked about draft arguments, and they pointed out a whole bunch of arguments, quite a few of which you all actually were responded to, or could be very easily responded to under other responses. They said, well, you got the increased cost and increased original purpose and all that sort of thing. All of these arguments fit very neatly into the overall arguments that they were addressing. There was no big issue left out of the last affirmative speech. Everything can be addressed under the main issue here, which is what I'm going to do now by looking at voting issues. We're going to look at three main issues that kind of cover everything that's come out of today's round. So the first voting issue you can write down is that expansion threatens Russia. Expansion threatens Russia. Now, they disputed this. They said Russia is not valued to wish more than it was successful in 2009. I would point out that back in our last meeting, we read you the new Russian military doctrine, which was approved in 2010, identifying NATO expansion as a national threat. That's how things stand with Russia. Clearly, Russia is a threat. The second voting issue, the second broad issue we can look at, is that expansion destabilizes Europe. We've seen this through multiple pieces of evidence. First of all, through the terrorism event. They said, well, it's specific to the nations joining. It was specific to ex-Soviet and ex-Warsaw Pact countries. These are the countries joining, very specific. And the second way to destabilize Eastern Europe is through these increased in tensions, as we've seen through evidence I've heard about, the multiple pieces of evidence I brought up, like 2AC. There's been tons of evidence saying that actually this increases tensions, destabilizes Eastern Europe. And thirdly, and most importantly, expansion decreases U.S. security. This really has only been an argument in the negative team by evidence from NATO itself. Clearly, our expansion policy is bad for everyone involved. It's bad for Russia, bad for Eastern Europe, and most importantly, bad for us, which is why I would strongly urge you to vote affirmative. Thank you.